Kathy Cox. Coming up tonight on the CHRO Evening Edition, 3 out of 4 doctors recommend a no to the Harris government offer. Bad timing for trick-or-treaters. Ontario gets its first taste of winter. And sometimes being a pack rat has its rewards. Good evening. Thumbs down. About 75% of Ontario's doctors have voted against the government's offer. The final word was to have come from the Council of the Ontario Medical Association, though. The OMA panel voted on the deal today, and we heard a short time ago that they have turned it down as well. Baytown's Leon Corby reports.
As the Ontario Medical Association's governing council arrived for their crucial meeting today, they were greeted by 200 young doctors in training. They held a silent candlelight vigil. It was a last-minute attempt to convince the association leadership that they must turn the tentative deal down, a deal that would have given doctors more money, but in return, restrict where physicians, especially new ones, could practice.
I think the messaging inside the general council will be clear that billing number restrictions not only are bad, but they won't work.
Most of the OMA's membership didn't like the deal either. 17,000 physicians voted in a province-wide referendum. 76% of them said no. Only 24% voted to accept the deal. But the final decision was up to the 250 members of the governing council, and they could not ignore the message.
The grassroots have spoken, the doctors in the field out there have expressed their opinion, and council has acted accordingly.
The council rejected the deal and is calling on the government to go back to the table and try again. In the interim, a group representing specialists is promising to postpone their job actions. But one splinter group of the OMA, called the Coalition of Family Physicians, which claims to represent 3,000 doctors, is unhappy and says it will stop accepting new patients tomorrow.
As a result of them not yet extending their hand to involve us in negotiating the future of the healthcare system, we cannot add patients to our current practices as of November 1st.
Also unclear at this point is the status of an ongoing job action by some of the province's obstetricians. When asked about that, the specialist coalition said that's still up in the air. Leon Corby, BBS News, Toronto.
The snow flurry activity we got off and on today set up a cold night for trick-or-treaters. Here's what they got just northwest of us in North Bay today. The snow could be seen in Ontario from Toronto to Sault Ste. Marie and much of north and eastern Ontario and west Quebec. The snow forced the closure of the Trans-Canada north of Sault Ste. Marie this morning, and driving is dangerous south of Sudbury. Meantime, Ontario hydro officials say close to 100 Petawawa area residents were left in the dark for several hours last night after those strong winds knocked a large tree onto a live hydro line. It happened on Black Bay Road near County Road 26. The weight of the tree broke the charged line, causing a small electrical fire on the ground. Well, choices, choices. The Harris government is taking a long, hard look at its spending this week, trying to decide where it is going to slash a promised $3 billion in cuts. Baytown's Dan Miles reports.
Cabinet ministers are meeting behind closed doors today and tomorrow to identify $3 billion more in cuts. The Harris government has already outlined $5 billion in reductions, and this is the final part of a commitment made in the common sense revolution.
I mean, the good news for us is government was so big and bloated and fat when we took over that you can find these kinds of savings.
But the premier admits this will not be an easy exercise. The government's options are limited. It has promised not to reduce health care spending below $17.4 billion, by far the largest budget in the province.
And at the end of the day, people will get the service, garbage will be picked up, kids will be taught in school, and health care services will be there. But there may be fewer public sector workers.
Harris says the reductions will be made in the most fair and reasonable way possible. He insists the long-term benefits of a balanced budget will far outweigh the short-term difficulties experienced by any cuts. Finance Minister Ernie Eves will announce specific details during an economic statement at the end of November. Dan Miles, BBS News, Toronto.
A group that keeps tabs on spending habits by the federal government is sounding its siren. The Canadian Taxpayers Federation says the Federal Industry Department has given away $282 million in wasteful business grants.
According to the Canadian Taxpayers Federation, the money has been flowing out of Industry Minister John Manley's department so fast, he should be dressed as the Prince of Pork Barreling this Halloween.
Listen, you know, if you've been around politics long enough, how did the grants get distributed? And it's often done on an MP basis.
Among the grants handed out, $3,300 to Georges Voix of Longueuil, Quebec to string tennis rackets. $4,500 to Robert Bone of Sioux Valley, Manitoba to fix a farm tractor. And $3,600 to Catherine St. Amant of Midland to establish a Mary Kay cosmetics business. And then there are the big handouts. $100,000 to a numbered company in Lively, Ontario to build a golf course. $500,000 to the Consumers Association, in part to do a study on tax reform. $412,000 to the Vancouver Island Advanced Technology Center to establish an internet site for cultural companies. We talked to some of the companies that received the federal grants, and they said they used the money to expand their businesses, to create new jobs, or to turn part-time positions into full-time ones. But the Taxpayers Federation says that's not fair to the businesses that aren't getting federal handouts.
They should have been doing that with their own money and not with taxpayers' money. Why should we be subsidizing specific businesses?
The Taxpayers Federation even pointed out that Heritage Canada, another department of the federal government, got a $100,000 grant from industry to produce those Heritage Minutes that you see on television.
That report from Baytown's Bill Hutchison. Thousands of Ontario students will enroll in college this year, but many aren't sure what to expect when they get there. Well, to answer some of their questions, Pembroke's Algonquin College held an open house today. CHRO's Cindy Edwards reports.
Honestly, if you want to get here, there's a way for you to get here.
This question and answer session is giving high school students a chance to talk to college students about workload, self-discipline, college requirements, and cost. Students are finding out that college is nothing like high school.
Some days it could be 6 hours of school, some days it could be four. You've got definitely have more homework.
It also requires money. And although college is cheaper than university, cost is still a major concern.
I plan on going here because I can live at home and it'll be a lot cheaper for me.
I know it's a lot of money, but I think it's worth it in the end when you get your job.
And most students share that optimism.
In the end, you're going to come out going into a job knowing what to do.
This open house is a lot more than just a tool to get students to attend Algonquin College.
Information on other schools is free for the taking. And students are getting a chance to meet representatives from 14 different community colleges.
So it affords them the opportunity to meet a college representative from a college of their choice and find out what it's like, what they need to gain entrance to that college program, and what the job opportunities are like after.
As these students check out the forestry technician program, they do so with the hope that a few more years of this will eventually lead to this. Cindy Edwards, CHRO News.
Coming up on the evening edition, no one would invest in his invention, so he marketed himself, and he's laughing all the way to the bank.
The evening edition is brought to you in part by Cantel Superior Cellular.
Live and well in Canada today, just ask Arnie Marks. Arnie is a fisherman turned inventor who is reeling in a growing share of the market with something called the Rod Buddy. Company after company turned his idea down. And now, Arnie Marks is showing them all. Marks is in Pembroke this week giving Valley fishermen a look at his invention. CHRO's Dave Henderson reports.
Like most fishermen, Arnie Marks spent a lot of time fighting tangled lines. And when he couldn't find a solution, he invented one.
Well, I pulled 12 rods out of my closet all at the same time. The lines were all tangled up. I went to the store to buy a rod buddy. They weren't there. And 3 years ago, I decided to heck with it. I'm going to see if I can make a marketable product. And I did. Little clips. They go on each side. They go up. And you're ready to go fishing. That simple.
But Marks had a real problem finding a big-name manufacturer to pick up his Rod Buddy. So he formed his own company. Since then, the Rod Buddy has hit the market in a very big way.
I'm across Canada. Most major department stores are carrying it. And I'm getting raves from both states in Canada and interest in Japan, the Netherlands. Sold some to Singapore, which really surprised me. So all around, fishermen like my product.
And Arnie is branching out. He's marketing a new Japanese invention to go along with his Rod Buddy. That's right, it's the Net Buddy.
Simple, easy to pack away, won't trip on it in your boat. trunk of your car, opens up, one flip, and then fully extends again.
Arnie and his buddies will be at the Pembroke Mall until Saturday. Dave Henderson, CHRO News.
People will save just about anything. Old love letters, report cards, and ticket stubs can be found in most homes. As for receipts, they usually end up in the garbage after a few years. But that's not the case in Pembroke. And as CHRO's Elizabeth Davis reports, it's paying off.
Whoever comes up with a bill of sale from our store with the oldest date, I'll give $100. For the second oldest, $50.
More than 100 bills of sale came in. Two stood out.
I knew people kept bills, but I didn't know so many people kept bills so long.
How long is long? One bill was dated June 1956. Another, August 1950.
The oldest was for a BD Ringer washer my father sold, and the second was for a BD Ringer washer that I sold.
The contest brought back some fond memories for this retiring businessman and for the daughters of the women who saved their receipts. Evelyn Gaylert wasn't surprised when she came across the old bill of sale. Her mom saved everything. Now she follows in her footsteps. Lucille Cleish wasn't surprised either. Her mother, Rose, doesn't throw anything out.
She's got things. You wouldn't believe the things that you come across. She's got receipts way back there.
Lucille isn't sure how her mother is going to spend her $50. As for Evelyn...
Well, I need another occasional chair, so I may just look around and see what George has.
So the next time you purchase something, you may want to hang on to the receipt. You never know. It could mean money in your pocket. Elizabeth Davis, CHRO News.
Evening edition weather brought to you by the Rosso Home Care Building Center.
All that work on a Halloween costume and you might have to put a winter coat over top of it. It's a cold one out there for trick-or-treaters. Let's join Bob now with a look at what's ahead. Bob?
All right, we got a great Halloween forecast. Bundle up the kids though. A little windy, a little cold. Hang on, I gotta... Oh, watch this. Ah, boo! Boo! Yeah, I'm here on Bank Street scaring the kids. Yeah, the Halloween forecast, it's a little windy, and it has been all day. It's windy, and, well, it'll continue windy overnight tonight. We'll take a look at today's conditions. Hang on a second. All right, here's how today looked in Ottawa on the Valley. It was cloudy, and then we had some sunny breaks in the afternoon. Clouds have returned, topped out. It was cool, only about 4 degrees today. With the winds, they were pretty high, around 50 kilometers per hour at some points. The humidity at 57%, barometer falling at 100.3. Tonight, partly cloudy, isolated flurries. I should have mentioned we had some flurries, particularly in Pembroke. Some of it stayed on the ground as well. Down to about -2, westerly winds still high overnight, 30% chance of more isolated flurries. Here's the map, -2 in Ottawa, -1 for most centers, Pembroke, Petawawa. Friday, here's the 3-day forecast. Cloudy, light rain or wet flurries, could go one way or another, 40% chance of precipitation with a high around 5 degrees. Saturday, same. Sunday, just a degree higher, but still the same conditions. So, yeah, we can feel winter coming. Where am I? All right, back to the desk.
He can be scary when he wants to be. Brian joins us now with a look at sports. And it got kind of messy near the end of the game last night.
A little bit
rough.
Yes, it did, Kathy. Good evening, everyone. The Ottawa Senators and the Kings played to a 2-2 tie at the Correll Center last night in a game seen here on CHRO. And judging by the calls on the fan network after the game and the coach's reaction, the officiating left a lot to be desired, especially when Lance Pitlick was sucker-punched late in the overtime period.
Steven viciously punched him in the eye with his glove off, and I think did quite a bit of damage, actually. We'll just wait and see. I think the supervisor of official is here tonight, so it's probably his call. No, that's not my call to send things in. It's either general managers or supervisor of officials.
Yeah, I think it's disgusting to see something like that. I don't think it's got a place in this league, and, the referee's got to call it. Simple as that. I don't understand why he didn't call it, and... every year they're telling us we need to be they need to be stronger on calling penalties that are holding or on things like that, and they didn't call it, so it's disgusting.
Yes, it was, and because of that, Pitlick will be out of the lineup tomorrow night. He suffered a severe cut on his cheek and a scratched eye. Senators host Detroit tomorrow night. We will have that game here on CHRO starting at 7:30. Coming up tonight, just three games. The Leafs play the Islanders in Uniondale. The Bruins are in Hartford. And Tampa Bay is at home to take on Philadelphia. One other note about the Senators, them, the team, and local businesses have joined forces to create a new program called Partners in Caring. They help charities and disadvantaged children attend NHL games. And some of them got to go last night to see the Sens play the Kings.
For us, it means that we're able to give back to the community. The grocer in your town is always taking money off of you. Now it's the time to give it back. So we're very happy to give it back to such a worthy cause.
Well, basically what it means for Eastersfield children is it provides them an opportunity to go to the Senators games and enjoy a really fabulous night out with their siblings and their family members. It also provides to us much needed funding for our program.
I was instrumental in getting National Grocers and your independent grocer stores involved in the program, and actually we've got a number of other things going right now in which we hope to be able to buy some more seats.
What's your favorite team? Your favorite hockey team?
Ottawa Senators, that's right.
Well, in baseball, Alex Rodriguez, who began the season batting ninth for Seattle and became the top hitter in the majors at age 21, is the Associated Press Major League Player of the Year. He finished up batting .358, 36 home runs. He also drove in 123 runs in his first full year in the big leagues. Meanwhile, 40-year-old Paul Molitor will apparently be back with the Minnesota Twins next season. Reports say he has reached agreement on a two-year contract worth over $6 million. David Braley is the new owner of the BC Lions, but there is a catch. He will only take over if the team can sell about 15,000 season tickets by early January. Braley, of course, is the former owner of the Hamilton Tiger Cats. Well, in just over a decade, the Upper Ottawa Valley has become a real power in women's ringette. In fact, the past two seasons, teams have returned home with provincial championships. And this year's season is just about to get started.
It was a slow start for the sport of ringette in the Upper Valley about 10 years ago. But with dedicated players and coaches, the sport has taken off in the past couple of seasons. In fact, last year, the city of Pembroke hosted their first regional prelim tournament. And two competitive teams, the Bellets and Petites, won gold medals at the provincial championships in Cambridge. This season, close to 200 girls are taking part in the Upper Valley Ringette League. House League competition begins next week. And what looks so promising for the sport in this area is the number of young girls coming out to learn the game.
Oh, it's great for it to grow. Our numbers are about the same as always, but like I said, we have a lot of young girls, and that's what makes it grow. And a lot of young parents come in and help out with the association.
But while there's growth among the younger players, the veteran ladies are having problems putting a team together. The Debs, players 19 years of age and up, are still looking for a coach and a sponsor. And in this area, it's been particularly difficult finding enough players to make up a team. And that can be very frustrating for girls that want to keep playing.
I don't know where else to go, what else to do to get people interested. I've tried for years to encourage the sport. I've coached for 7 years. I've done my time. Why can't I get a coach? Why doesn't somebody give me the time that I've put into it? I enjoy it. It's in my blood. I can't get it out. I want to play. I just want to play.
Okay.
One frustrated lady.
Yes, she was.
Medical news up next. Don't go away.
CHRO-TV wants to hear from you. Contact us with your news tips or about your community events by phone, by fax, or by email.
If they're not already at your door, they will be soon. Halloween is an exciting night for kids, but it can also be pretty frightening, especially for small children. Sandra Moss has some advice for parents in tonight's Village Pharmacy Medical Report.
The sounds and sights of Halloween can be spooky, even for us grown-ups. This is hardly kid stuff. Aside from the usual treats, the tricks can be overwhelming to children under five. Something as simple as a mask can cause trauma for babies and toddlers.
2- and 3-year-olds don't yet have the reasoning skills to understand the transformation from the smiling parent face to the witch.
Once you have the costumes under control, it's time to think of ways to handle the scary stuff outside on trick-or-treat night.
I think it's really important for parents to read their children's cues and to watch how comfortable they are in approaching a house.
It's also a good idea to check out the neighborhood to spot any real spooky houses before venturing out. Smaller children may need to be carried door to door. 6, 7, and 8-year-olds may think they're ready for the haunted house experience, but look for a quick exit just in case. Nightmares and fear of the dark are quite common in the days following Halloween.
Provide support, relax the bedtime rules a little bit, leave the hallway light on, leave the door open, and reassure the child. And those kinds of effects should be short-lived.
Sandra Moss for CBS News.
Now, the Trucks Plus Community Happenings Calendar.
Once the kids are done trick-or-treating, you may want to attend tonight's Halloween dance at the Knights of Columbus Hall in Pembroke. Prizes for best costumes, $3 per person, $5 per couple, and it's proceeds going to the United Way. Deer season begins next week, and the Pembroke Outdoor Sportsman's Club is holding a big deer contest. Weigh-ins are at Risto's or Uncle Jim's Meat Market in Pembroke from November 4th to the 16th. For more information, call the club at 732-8483. And that's our time. Thanks for joining us. Have a happy and safe Halloween, folks. Good night.